Thank you guys for sticking by to hear me out. I hope you're going to learn a thing or two. It's going to be especially useful for developers. Or if you're in some team, maybe you can just leak some news, what I'm going to say. So let me first introduce myself. I'm Tomas Tumosa from Lithuania, and I consider myself a VR artist. Mainly, I'm a developer, a programmer, but I also do like VR sculpting. I do VFX. I do shaders. I'm just like a one-man band. Like I consider myself a rogue. So during the year of 2019, I had a pleasure of working on two very interesting Oculus Quest games. So they were not launched, they were not anything too big. They were just mostly prototypes to see if just a proof of concept, if it works, what we're building. So let me just start off without any further ado. So what I see currently in the VR world, what are the current problems? First of all, it's clunkiness and immobility. So with the traditional VR, you know how there has to be lots of wires. You have to plug it into a strong computer for the games to work. And also, the next problem is that despite VR seeming like it's the revolutionary platform to break through the text and voice, you can now communicate through body language and you can interact with other people. But for now, with a traditional wired VR, it still feels antisocial. Like if you're looking at a person from third perspective, you don't really that person who is in VR alone, he looks like he's out of the group. He's alone, and you're here. Like some people from the previous talk stressed how it's still a problem. So the games I did were with Oculus Quest. And briefly, if some of you may not know about Oculus Quest, it's a standalone self-contained headset, which basically it means that you have an operation system inside the headset. So you kind of put it on, turn the power on, and you're in Oculus home, so you don't need any phones, any computers, nothing. And it also has 6 degrees of freedom, so like you can walk around. It's not constrained to like phone VRs where you just kind of look around and don't have any interactions. So the thing was that how the tracking works, if anyone's interested. The tracking is inside out, meaning that you don't need any sensors for this VR headset. You have the inside out, meaning there are cameras that are tracking depth of your outside surroundings. And based on that, it makes like 3D projection, and it knows if the point where the camera's got it, if it gets closer to you, if it gets further away, and that way they can determine, the headset can determine your position in space so that you can move around. So this covers the immobility and the clunkiness because there's no wires. This is a great solver. But of course, it doesn't go. It's not all positive with Oculus Quest. It's not a perfect device, since first of all, it has weaker graphics than the standard computer, computer wired VRs, because the whole computer chip has to fit inside your headset, and also it has a battery life, meaning that if you play for 2 to 3 hours, you need to recharge your headset, and you can of course use it with a wire, but it's not really a constraint. It's just that the Quest itself has a weight on it. So after like an hour or 2 hours of gameplay, you already feel weary. Your head feels weary. You need some sort of a break. So it's not really a constraint to charge it up. The only place where this matters, the battery life where it matters, is if you have like this VR room kind of gameplay, and then you need when your Quest loses its battery, you need to switch them out with some new Quests and leave those two to charge, for example. So that's the only constraint of the battery life. Oh, and also the antisocial Quest really that's going to be my point. The project I've been working with is battling antisocial. So just when the Quest was released, this video of Dead and Buried was shown online. Of like 6-8 people playing in the same room, seeing each other as a virtual character and playing like a regular tag or laser tag, something like this, just with VR headsets, shooting each other. So the first game that I was building, which I want to talk about, is a co-location cooperation VR game, meaning that just like the Dead and Buried, I was instructed, Would it be possible to make with homemade solution so that two players with Oculus Quest, no any external sensors, so they could stand in the same place, in the same room, and see each other's virtual character in place where their real bodies are? So, first of all, the solution to how I achieved this thing was, first of all, you need to understand the guardian system. So Quest has a guardian system, meaning that when you turn the headset on, you need to paint, you see the real world view outside through the camera. So like the cameras outside are translating the view, so you don't have to take off the glasses, you see the real world from inside your headset. So then you kind of paint around, seeing the real world view, you kind of with the controller paint around your play space, and that becomes like the play space, the regular play space of your VR gameplay. So if you go to the edge of your play space, the blue lines appear. If you go through the blue lines, you fade into the real world. So you don't get disoriented, you know exactly where you are. So with this in mind, of course, I just quick gameplay of what this game was about. It's just tower defense, two people in the same room defending against flying drones who want to destroy the portal, who want to go into the portal, and that's that. So, the trick was, it was actually pretty simple. It seemed from like inspection, from the reading about it, it seemed that it was going to be really difficult to do this, the synchronization, but the solution that I had, of course, I don't think it's the best solution, but it's as good as it worked for our purposes. And if anyone's interested, you can also do it. It's gonna work. So how it works is that you have to take two headsets. We developed this game for two players. So take two headsets and draw the play space of both headsets from exactly the same space. So you stand in. You have to face on the both sets face the same way. You have to go through all the steps. You have to, when you paint the guardian, you have to start from the same corner. Just the same process. Make two identical play spaces. And when you go into the game, of course, you need the networking plugin like Photon or something. But this is the crucial point, to have two identical play spaces, so that when you go into the game, which has the networking plugin already there, the Quest tracks your position from the stage, from your play space. So if the two stages are identical, then you can put the headset, play the game from any place in the room, and you're going to have the appropriate space in virtual environment. So if I open the game standing here, the other person opens up the game here, you can really see the person over there, because the two play spaces are synced. And so it's not the best solution, as you have to do this manual work of syncing two play spaces. It doesn't really work if like two people who have Quest meet and say, hey, let's play together or something. It has that kind of constraint, but for like VR rooms or you kind of arcades or something where you come and it's already pre-made, this works, and it works pretty well. If you're making a cooperation game, please make sure you have some cooperation. I had some time constraints, so I couldn't develop any of them. So what my game was is that you kind of just shoot the enemies with a gun. You can use the grappling hook to kind of catch their eyes to power up your weapon. But basically, the most interaction I had with two players was that you could shoot the same enemy, the both players shooting the same enemy. But I didn't have anything to share between players. That was like in plans, but I didn't have time. So what we ended up with is that two players are standing side by side and just shooting. And this game could have been played alone. It didn't really. There wasn't really a necessity to have two players. So if you're interested, this is a quick trailer of what how it came to be. I'm just not going to go through it all, just to see how people are playing inside. So this was the game. So they're like kind of standing side by side, and they're not really interacting, but the communication worked. So make sure you have some cooperation if you're making this kind of game. And the other one I did was one versus one multiplayer. So this one was a bit more interesting to me because it had more it's more like widely accessible if we were to make it happen for real, like release it. So I had built this for 1 month. I had built it in 1 month alone for the local Lithuanian exposition, just to see if we can make two people play one against another in the same space. So the location aspect of it was much easier because we did not need to like to sync up the guardians. What we ended up with is that we have one shared space, like one big space. And what we ended up with is like we divided for the two players. We divided one player gets one half of the free space, and the other one gets the other half of the space. So it was a solution, but this game could also be played through the internet through strangers. So you don't need to have the same kind of space to play this game. But this also brings a few more things that you need to take care of if you're building one versus one. Is that you need to make the game fair. Like, what happens if one person has a bigger play space than another? So what I did to counter that was when two players log into the game, I check which player has the smaller guardian. And I use that guardian size to scale both of the pods. So like two players are on their pods. One is red, one is blue. And I just scale those pods according to the player with the smaller guardian so that both people have the same size pod. And the other thing I had to take care of was people are different heights. So the thing, quickly, what the game was about was that you have three statues. Which generate the respective color projectiles, and you have a slingshot. You can take the charged projectiles from the statue, load it up, and shoot at the enemy's statue of the same color. And if you make your palm face outwards to your enemy, the shield appears, and you can block the projectiles. So the other thing I had to do to kind of make it more fair was when the player logs in, I check his height and then accordingly make the statues appear lower or higher. So that's the thing you have to take care of, and that's just how it all looked. Yeah, so the separate guardians already took care of that. And also the client-side prediction, when you're making, it's easier to make a networking game that is cooperational, because all the aspects of networking, there's some clunkiness. It's quite difficult to do networking with a Photon or whichever plugin you use. So using default methods for client-side prediction doesn't really work for one versus one multiplayer, as you don't want to lose by the game with game not being fair to you. So because in this game what happened, I did not fix the issue, was that if you're putting up your shield, at the last millisecond when you see the projectile approach, if you put your hand up to deflect at the last second, the bullet is gonna go through because it takes time for the calls to go through the server and whatever. So you have to kind of predict that the person is gonna move there. So this is the more challenging aspect of making one versus one multiplayer. But the rewards are bigger because this kind of multiplayer game could be played from anywhere, not just in the same space like the co-location one. Right. So and of course the exhibition, it went quite fun, but you make sure that when you're making, when you're promoting a game or something, make sure that you have something that they can take, they can like something or subscribe to the game you're making to keep following it. Because what we had is that we were so short on time that we didn't have anything, just the game. And so when people would come and play the game, they liked it. But all we could say is like, did you like the game? They say, yeah, we did like the game. And say, okay, good luck then, see you around. And we didn't have anything to say, hey, go like this page. We were so short in time. It was one month's project. So it was a huge waste of time to show them how to play the game. So have something to promote. Yeah. And for the conclusion, I don't know, Oculus is a great platform to start making multiplayer experiences in VR. It has none of the cables and all of the social aspect. So that was it for me. Thank you for sticking by. It was a pleasure talking here.
Thomas, that was incredible. You said, did you even take a breath? That was, there was a lot going on there. And again, we've been exploring the idea of how players can work together in a game, which I think you showed that beautifully, the idea of two players in a virtual space. And of course, they don't have to be actually in the same room, can they? They can, that with that game, they could be anywhere on the internet, yeah, right, playing together.
Like two kind of ways. Like one that I developed was the one versus one, which you can be anywhere in the world, but you can also be in the same space. And the co-location was, which preferably like you co-locate in the same location, you stay. So this one has to be in the same space. That's co-location.
Now to me, the non-locality of that shows that there is an opportunity for really meaningful player experiences in shared VR environments. Do you feel at the end of that development, and that was a very short project life cycle there, you had a month, right?
Yeah, and that was like, that's all I did. I just kept on grinding along my house, and all the models, everything is all been...
Incredible. Now, so what do you think afterwards? What do you want to try and achieve in your next project? I assume you're going to carry on, keep working in VR.
Right. So, if I have time, yeah. I have a great idea which I really want to pursue. This is going to be a major project, but my end game, which I really want to achieve, is to make some sort of VR Pokemon, which could create new jobs. What I mean is that you have machine learning Pokemons running around in some woods. You could, you roam around, you explore, right? You can catch those Pokemon, and they're not going to just evolve or learn tricks by leveling up. You would have to kind of have treats inside your pockets or inventory, and you would have to say with your voice commands, hey, do flamethrower for whatever, Charmander or whatever. He would sometimes maybe do, and you would give a treat to him. Then he will get his reward. It's going to be machine learning Pokemon. And this way he's going to learn, evolve, and you're going to have your own little Pokemon, which are going to be specifically trained by how you train them. And this way you can have like big esport events where the best Pokemon trainers who dedicated their life to just sit in the game and train their Pokemon to be the best could have like the grand some stage where you could be sponsored by some like Navi or whatever, and you could just play the Pokemon game against others, and people could be spectating, and you can have like actually make Pokemon Master a true job in later times. I want to contribute to making like the virtual the new real, or part of the real.
Yeah, that's a really good point. I think the idea, if we're thinking about virtual reality when we're developing products, as Alex said about his lily pads, the idea of functionality being related to each other, if we take those and put those together, you can see that the idea of machine learning and virtual reality is very interesting for creating game characters that have meaning other than just talking to them and getting a response back. So it's worth thinking about how virtual reality enables higher forms of communication, not just verbal, but gesture communication. And those ideas, as you say, that's a lovely illustration about training them with using treats, etc. And again, using body language. So non-verbal communication is something that often gets overlooked. We're just looking at in terms of virtual reality, how we can push objects, pick objects up, but there's how we can use nonverbal communication. One last thing.
Yes, the immersion that comes in VR is mainly with people interaction. If you're playing a single player game, for example, like Beat Saber or something, it's just arcadey, and you don't really get the immersion of being in VR, you're just kind of playing a game that's cooler than most games because you can see around and walk around. What brings the immersion is seeing other people kind of roaming and being in the same space as you and be able to talk. But the machine learning, like for example, the Pokemon, they can be the other kind of way of bringing the immersion because they're not like simple program, they can learn. So the people can bring the immersion, and the machine learning kind of animals or bots or whatever can bring immersion. That's what I think.